This video is brought to you by Guardio. For years, special kinds of semiconductors called perovskites have been promised revolutionary improvements compared to traditional silicon solar cells. Perovskites could hold the key to higher efficiency at lower costs. In some cases, perovskites have been shown to offer a 250% performance boost, but scientists have been working on this tech since the 1990s. So what do we have to show for it today? Well, this feels like yet another piece of overhyped, planet-saving tech perpetually 10 years away from adoption, right? Well, maybe not. This might finally be on the market before the end of this year. Let's look at five perovskite solar panel advances since the last time we talked about it. I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. Perovskites are yet another example of old technology that's just starting to gain some traction in the world of renewables. But how old? Well, it was first discovered all the way back in 1839, and it's a family of materials with the same crystal structure as calcium titanium oxide. However, it wasn't until the 1950s that they saw use in fuel cells, superconductors, and other applications. Even then, it would take another half century before they were first used as the optical absorption layer in solar cells. So why are so many people hyped about the use of perovskites in solar cells? I won't go into all the details because I've covered a lot of the specifics in another video, which I'll link to in the description. But in a nutshell, as abundant as silicon is, there's a theoretical limit to the efficiency that we can achieve. It's referred to as the Shockley-Quasar limit, but perovskites can go beyond that limit just by a little bit, and they promise to be significantly cheaper. If perovskites are so cheap and efficient, why aren't they everywhere? Well, the first issue is lifespan. Currently, perovskites just can't stand up to the typical 25-year warranty of a silicon cell. Oxygen, moisture, and heat can all reduce perovskites' generational output and lifespan. And unfortunately, the solar panel is sitting outside is going to be facing a lot of oxygen, moisture, and heat. And this can happen quickly, with some perovskite cells reduced to just 80% capacity in 2 years or less. That's a far cry from silicon's 25 plus years and beyond. And to prevent this, a capping layer of lead is usually applied to the cell, but lead is, of course, heavy and toxic. And as these short-lived cells age, break down, or get discarded, that lead can escape and harm the local environment. So has anyone addressed these challenges? Has there been any meaningful progress or new innovations that bring perovskites closer to reality and retail? In a word, yes. So let's look at five advances since the last time we covered this. First up is a study led by Chun-Li Guo, a professor of optics at the University of Rochester, my hometown, and it suggests that perovskites have the potential to become radically more efficient. Now, over the course of the research, Guo and his team found a way to massively boost perovskites' carrier diffusion length. By replacing the glass surface you'd usually find in perovskite cells with a metal or a metamaterial composed of alternating layers of silver and aluminum oxide, the researchers created a sort of electron mirror. Now, this mirroring effect ended up increasing performance by 250%. Now, before we get too hyped up, let's clarify that this isn't a direct 250% jump. Broadly speaking, solar panel efficiency usually refers to power conversion efficiency, or PCE, which is the percentage of solar energy shining on the PV's device that's converted into usable electricity. In this case, we're talking about how long the electrons essentially bounce around inside the cell before they dissipate, or the carrier diffusion length. That's where the 250% jump is happening. Now, if that's a little confusing, consider the offshore wind turbines we explored in a recent video. And just because we double the wind turbine's radius doesn't mean we get a straightforward 3, 4, or 5 times power increase. There's a lot of changes to internal components beyond the blade size that impact the final output result. It's the same with these cells. Just because we vastly increase the photosensitivity doesn't mean that we vastly increase the final power output. However, this is still a very noteworthy development because it opens the door for far more advanced perovskite cells down the line. And here's why. Typical solar panels are essentially two oppositely charged semiconductors that are stuck together, forming a neutral zone. Now, ideally, incoming photons of sunlight knock the electrons out of the neutral zone, and then the solar panel's electrodes capture that as usable electricity. It's grossly oversimplified, but in a nutshell, that's what's happening. The problem is that these recently freed electrons often recombine with their polar opposite or their respective semiconductor layers before the electrodes can capture them. And that seriously hampers their ability to actually make electricity. But when Guo and his team added a metal substrate below the perovskite layer, they found that the freeish flowing electrons within the metal layer moved the recently freed electrons in the perovskite. This ultimately kept the electrons free longer, which meant more opportunities for their charge to be collected. Now, theoretically, this should allow cells to generate more energy with the same sunlight and ultimately to be more efficient. It's especially cool because other methods for achieving similar results require complex chemical engineering. Instead, this approach involves a simple, stable piece of metal. And while we're on stability, let's take a look at a Star Trek-sounding way to improve that. But before we get into that advance, I'd like to share something else that's important to our daily lives from today's sponsor, Guardio. You may have noticed an increase in the number of scammers in my YouTube comments. Well, pretty much all YouTube comments. It's like a constant game of whack-a-mole to get rid of those and to keep everybody safe from getting scammed or from phishing attempts. My parents just recently fell victim to a fake ad that popped up on a website and tried to get my dad to go to a malware-riddled website. Now, people think that things like two-factor authentication protect you from scams, but it doesn't. If someone gets a hold of your computer and your browser data from a phishing attempt, it's game over. Guardio can help protect you from phishing and harmful websites, monitor cross-platform for your information getting leaked, stop dangerous downloads before they've started, and stop those annoying pop-ups. Malware is everywhere, even in legitimate places like Facebook ads. Guardio has recently researched this specific issue and is the only tool that can detect and block those malicious ads. Guardio is a simple browser extension used by over 1 million people that you can install in Google Chrome or Microsoft Edge. It will actively warn you and stop those things from happening. It's so important to keep your information secure. Get started today with real-time alerts and a free security scan. It only takes 30 seconds to get set up. And they have a special deal for my community to get 20% off the monthly subscription. If you want a clean and secure browsing experience, go to guard.io/undecided. The link's in the description, and thanks again to Guardio and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now let's get back to the second advance on stability. Researchers at North Carolina State University have discovered a very Star Trek-sounding way to enhance the perovskite's durability. Remember that perovskites are a multicrystalline material. That means that when you're growing a perovskite, that material forms as a series of crystals or grains. These grains are responsible for absorbing light and generating the charges that become an electrical current. Normally, ions find their own path through the perovskite grain, causing tiny chemical reactions and molecular changes that shorten a cell's lifespan. However, the NCSU group found that by channeling the ions into defined routes between the crystals, which they call grain boundaries, they formed a sort of ionic desire path. I told you it sounded kind of Star Trek-y. By moving through these designated lanes instead of bouncing around, the ions cause less harm to the cell, leading to more stability and longer lifespans. Now, the third up is Liu Zhang and his team out of Penn State, who found a way to quickly and easily manufacture high-grade perovskites. Now, the typical fabrication process for perovskites involves wet chemistry. The materials are liquefied in a solvent solution and then solidified into a film. Now, while it's very efficient for smaller applications, the process is slow and expensive, so it just doesn't scale up well. And the solvents in the manufacturing process might also be toxic, so obviously not ideal. And to get around these hurdles, the Penn State team created halide perovskites using a method called spark plasma sintering, or the electrical and mechanical field-assisted sintering technique, also known as EmFast. Now, put simply, this technique involves applying an electric current and pressure to powders, causing a reaction that welds the powder into a new solid material. Now, you know the so-called unbreakable iron triangle? Cheap, fast, or good? You could only pick two. Well, EmFast may have just broken it. One of the benefits of the EmFast process is that it has a 100% yield, meaning that all the powder that you put down will be transformed into perovskites. Compare this to the 20 to 30% yields of the more common solution-based processing, and we're already off to a very cost-efficient start. Now, the process is also able to create 0.2 inches of perovskite per minute. That might not sound like a lot, but what would have taken days or weeks can now be done in mere minutes. EmFast? It's more like EM superfast. And this technique doesn't seem to sacrifice on quality either. As Zhang says, their properties can compete with single crystal perovskites. There's other benefits too. EmFast doesn't use solvents, so there's no need to worry about toxic materials. Plus, the sintering process can be performed in a way that's similar to 3D printing, allowing for layered perovskites tailored to a wide array of jobs. This includes not just better solar panels, but also enhanced X and gamma ray detectors. And even more innovative developments from EmFast could be right around the corner. And speaking of environmentally friendly materials, for number four, we have another exciting breakthrough from February. Like we mentioned earlier, perovskite cells unfortunately necessitate a capping layer made of toxic lead. But in seeking to make perovskite solar cells more eco-friendly, Professor Sum Ji Xian from Nanyang Technological University, or NTU, may have found a way to make them more efficient, stable, and market-ready. After a lot of testing, the NTU scientists used a full precursor solution, or FPS method, to coat perovskites with solutions containing metal halide salts and PEAI. Now, among the caps that were made with this method, they found the most effective was a non-toxic zinc-based compound. And I'm not going to even try to pronounce it. This is the name of it. And I'm sorry to any sleeper agents that I just activated. Now, it's able to convert 24.1% of the light captured to electricity. It comes close to the highest efficiency achieved so far by perovskite solar cells. As for the lifespan, the FPS-coated cells were able to maintain more than 90% of their ability to convert light into electricity for more than 1,000 hours of operation. And for context, perovskite cells without this coating typically drop to around 50% power conversion efficiency at just 300 hours. Now that said, there just hasn't been enough tests or even solid, agreed-upon standards to really compare perovskites here, let alone perovskites versus other types of solar cells, so it is difficult to say how good that really is. But good news, this method does seem eminently reproducible. During testing, NTU fabricated 103 FPS cells, and they all performed in the same manner, which shows this isn't just a fluke. And finally, number 5 is kind of a cheat. It's a sublist to my list. It seems like one university after another is handling every issue that you could think of, from toxicity to longevity to cost. And sure, all this progress is exciting, but so far I've only mentioned laboratory breakthroughs. Does any of this have any real-world applications? Is any of it on the market yet? Are we any closer to better solar panels now than we were last year? Absolutely. In fact, we're closer than you might think. Recent financial support and new measures from both the US government and the EU have contributed a lot to boosting various perovskite cell enterprises and helped them evolve past their pilot phases. This sublist is about commercialization. Oxford PV, who we checked out last year, is planning the commercial launch of its perovskite on silicon tandem cell this year, predicting a conversion efficiency of 27% and an energy yield of 24%. If all goes well, Oxford PV and German partner Helmholtz Zentrum Berlin, or HZB, plan to expand their pilot factory near the German capital and scale up production to 10 gigawatts by the end of the decade. And France is right behind them. The Solar Research Center, IPVF, has partnered with French manufacturer Voltex Solar to build a solar panel factory that will produce tandem four-terminal combination perovskite silicon cells. The partners aim to start production early next year and ramp up capacity to 5 gigawatts by 2030. And Germany is currently the EU's largest solar market, so it's no surprise that HZB is double-dipping in solar. Last year, they teamed up with Qcell, a Korean solar manufacturer, to establish a pilot manufacturing line for silicon perovskite tandem cells in Tollheim, Germany. This research project is tastefully named Pepperoni, or Pilot Line for European Production of Perovskite Silicon Tandem Modules on Industrial Scale. I prefer pepperoni. It aims to address perovskite's challenges and speed up the technology's mass manufacturing. The research side of this project is set to conclude in 2026, but by June of that year, they plan to be ready to mass produce perovskite tandem cells at competitive rates. And finally, Toronto-based QD Solar boasts a great efficiency rate, and they're actually ready for the market. The company's spin-coated and slide-dot-coated perovskite cells are designed with mass production in mind and boast efficiency ratings of 24% and 23.2% respectively. And better yet, they just had those numbers confirmed by a third party in February. Ultimately, it's easy to see why so many people are optimistic about perovskites. Perovskite solar cells have emerged as a promising photovoltaic technology for many reasons, and headway is being made on addressing several of perovskite's challenges, and it looks like commercialization is finally happening. By the end of this year or next, we should have some options on the market. As the developments we've talked about are incorporated into perovskite cells, it's going to continue to expand the sector and keep it growing. And not a moment too soon. So what do you think? Jump in the comments and let me know. And be sure to check out my follow-up podcast, Still to be Determined. We'll be discussing some of your feedback. And thanks to all my patrons who get ad-free versions of every video. And thanks to all of you for watching. I'll see you in the next one.